In Jesus' name we pray. Once again, we come to Revelation chapter 2. We're looking at a series of studies on the church. Jesus Christ had said, "Upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." And I pray that as God has called you to be a worker, to be a leader, to be a teacher, to be a minister, to be a pastor, to be an overseer, to be a women leader, a church, a children's church leader and teacher, and you as a church leader and campus church leader, I pray that every one of us will be successful in this work in Jesus' name. The series actually has a seven, because we have the seven churches of Asia Minor. We have this church that the Lord Jesus Christ told the beloved John to write to. The church in Ephesus, number one. The church in Smyrna, number two. The church in Pergamos, number three. The church in Thyatira, that's number four. And the church in Sardis, number five. The church in Philadelphia, number six. The church in Laodicea, chapter number seven. We've looked at this church and we're referring to them, number one, as a fundamental church in a pluralistic world. A fundamental church in a pluralistic world. Number two, a fearless church in a persecuting world. Number three, is a faltering church in a perverted world. Number four, is a feeble church in a putrefying world. And number five, is a formal church in a perishing world. Number six, a faithful church in a pessimistic world. And then number seven, a flattered church, self-flattering church in a permissive world. We're taking these churches one by one. We come now to the church. Look at chapter 2 of Revelation, chapter 2, verse 12. The church in Pergamos. The church in Pergamos. This is the faltering church in a perverted world. We're looking at Revelation chapter 2, verse 12. And to the angel of the church in Pergamos, write. To the angel of the church in Pergamos, right? Every time the Lord refers to these churches, he refers to the leader of the church, the minister of the church, the overseer in that church, the shepherd in that church. He refers to that as the angel of the church. The angel of the church. And we've been looking at the scripture to show that it's the minister that is called an angel. And that is referring to you now. You are a leader in the church. You're supposed to be the angel of that church. A little group house fellowship there, a little zone. There's you have some members, 60 members, 100 members there. You are the angel of that church of 100 membership strong. Or you are the woman leader. That they're supposed to be the angel over those women, leading them to an angelic life, a saintly life, a righteous life, a holy life, a godly life. Or you are the pastor over that district church, or the pastor over the group, or the pastor over the region, or you're the pastor over the state, or over the nation. It is referred to, you are referred to as the angel. Follow me to the Old Testament. We're looking at 2 Samuel chapter 14. 2 Samuel chapter 14. It's not a peculiar thing to Revelation, it's not a peculiar thing to the New Testament, that the leader over the people of God shall be referred to as an angel. We're looking at 2 Samuel chapter 14. In 2 Samuel chapter 14, I'm reading verse 17. It says in verse 17, "Then thine handmaid said, the word of my Lord the king shall now be comfortable, for as an angel of God, so is my Lord the king to discern good and bad. Therefore, the Lord thy God will be with thee." Now you see in that verse, it's referring to David there. And it says to discern good between good and bad. That is, the angels of God, they know the difference between righteousness and unrighteousness, between holiness and sinfulness. And so if you come to this characteristic yourself, that you're able to differentiate between good and bad, able to differentiate between righteousness and unrighteousness, able to differentiate between what is acceptable and what is not acceptable, able to differentiate between what is profitable in the kingdom of God and what is unprofitable in the work of God. That's why you are referred to as an angel, the angel of the church, because you have that characteristic. It also says, the Lord thy God be with thee. As God, the God of heaven, is with the angels, and the angels are with him. When there's that intimacy, that interaction, that connection, that you are part of the family of God, and God says, I walk in them, I dwell in them, I will be with you, and you will be with me. That intimacy then makes you like an angel of God. Look at verse 20. In verse 20, to fetch about this form of speech, as thy servant Joab done the scene, and my Lord is wise according to the wisdom of an angel of God. When your wisdom is not coming from the pit of hell, when your wisdom is not satanic, when your wisdom is not of the world, when your wisdom is coming from above, it's coming from God himself, and he gives you that heavenly wisdom, he gives you that holy wisdom, he gives you that sacred wisdom, he gives you that spiritual wisdom by which you're able to lead the people of God. That's why you are referred to as an angel of God, an angel of God, to know all things that are in the earth, to know all things that are in the earth. The angels are knowledgeable, and once you go into the scriptures, and he gives you the knowledge of the scriptures and the knowledge you need to control and to guide and to counsel and to teach and to lead the people of God to maturity and perfection, that's why you are called an angel. Come back to Revelation chapter 2. Revelation chapter 2, and to the angel of the church in Pergamos write, the church. Already we know that the church is ecclesia, is a called out people. Not only called out, the people who are purchased by the blood of Jesus Christ, the blood of the Redeemer, the blood of the Savior. We're told in Acts of the Apostles chapter 20. Acts of the Apostles chapter 20, I'm reading from verse 26. It says, wherefore I take you to record this day that I am pure from the blood of all men. That's the angel of the church right there. That's the apostle right there. That's an overseer right there. That's a faithful teacher, a faithful preacher of the word of God right there. It says, I take you to record. Look at all the things I've taught you. I am pure from the blood of all men, and for I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God. What can an angel do more than that? God sends an angel to this earth, either he sends him to the mother of Samson, or he sends him to Zechariah and Elizabeth, or whoever the Lord sends an angel to. All they will do is that they will declare the whole counsel of God in that place, and then they will leave. They're not going to take anything away from the word God has given them. They're not going to add anything to the word God has given them. And the apostle here, the preacher here, the teacher here, the leader here, the overseer here, he says, I am not shunned to declare unto you the whole counsel of God. That's why the Lord refers to us as faithful as angels are, so we're faithful. As devoted as angels are, so we're devoted. As committed to the totality of the revelation of God given to the angels, so we're devoted to the totality of the revelation given unto us, the angel of the church. Look at verse 28. Take heed therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock over the which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers to feed the church of God, which he has purchased with his own blood. Is the church that he has purchased, the church he has redeemed, and the church he wants to take from earth, he wants to take that church to heaven. But we say we're talking about a faltering church. Instead of the church standing solidly on the revelation of the word of God, the church is faltering, the church is feeble, the church is shaking, the church is trembling. But why? Look at the cause of that in verse 29. For I know this, that after my departing shall grievous wolves enter in among you, not sparing the flock, not sparing the church. Also of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things, to draw away disciples after them. They come from the perverted world, and then they come with perverse doctrine, perverse teaching, and then eventually the church is not watchful. If the church is not careful, the church then begins to falter. The church begins to tremble. The church begins to faint because of the perversion coming from the world. It says, therefore, watch and remember that by the space of 3 years I cease not to warn everyone night and day with tears. And now, brethren, I commend you to God. If we're going to save the church from faltering, if we're going to save the church from being feeble, if we're going to save and rescue the church from fainting, we need to commend that church back again to the word of the Lord. That's why it says, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you an inheritance among all them which are sanctified. I pray that that purpose the Lord wants to fulfill in us and through us, he will do it in Jesus' name. We're talking about this, a faltering church in a perverted world. The world in which we live is a perverted world. What makes the world perverted? First John chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 19. First John chapter 5, verse 19. And we know that we are of God, that's the church, and the whole world lies in wickedness. The whole world lies in the lap of the wicked one. That's what makes the world to be perverted. And there is so much influence that the world is trying to exert on the church. While the church is standing, while the church is holy, while the church is righteous, while the church is perfect, the world doesn't like that. They do not like something totally different, because we become the conscience of the world. And what we do, the way we stand, is bringing condemnation to them because of the condemnation and the conviction they're experiencing. That's why they want to bring their perverse understanding and their perverse system to have some impact on the church, a negative impact on the church. Jeremiah chapter 3, the state of the world that is trying to influence and corrupt the church. In Jeremiah chapter 3, verse 21, Jeremiah chapter 3, verse 21, it says, a voice was heard upon the high places, weeping and supplication of the children of Israel, for they have perverted their way. They have perverted their way. They mix so much with the world, and the influence of the world brought perversion unto them. They have perverted their way, it says, and they have dealt treacherously, and it says also that they have forgotten the Lord their God. They forget the word of God. They forget the standard that we have been given, because they have perverted their way. In Philippians chapter 2, it shows us the challenge we have and the commission we have, and what we ought to do in such a perverse world, in such a kind of twisted world, mind-twisting world. It tells us in Philippians chapter 2, verse 15, Philippians chapter 2, verse 15, that ye may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God, without rebuke, in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation. In the midst of a crooked and perverse community, in the midst of a crooked and perverse world, it says, among whom ye shine as light in the world, holding forth the word of life, that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have not run in vain, neither labored in vain. As we come to this church in Pergamos, we're back to Revelation chapter 2 now. Revelation chapter 2, as we come to this church, we see that Christ is talking to the church. and he confronts this church because of the corrupting influence of compromise that is coming into that church. And these epistles, or these seven letters written to the seven churches of Asia Minor, they were written to the churches mentioned, but the message of Christ in them transcends all those churches. You see that at the end of each message, he makes a personal application, and he says, he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Come to this chapter 2 verse 12. It says, unto the angel of the church in Pergamos write, these things says he which has the sharp sword with two edges. He's talking about himself. Now this is Christ that has, he has judicial authority. He has this two-edged sword coming out of his mouth, and he has the stern word of judgment, which is to fall on these compromisers in the church in Pergamos. Is the one who wields the sword of judgment. And every church that is tolerating evil or error or sin or iniquity or false doctrine will have the judgment come in upon them. I pray we'll escape the judgment in Jesus' name. And in view of the fact that there was imminent judgment coming upon the church in Pergamos, that is why he told John the beloved, write unto them, tell them, and warn them ahead of time before the judgment will come upon this faltering church in a perverted world. And when this letter came to them, they were to shake up and stand up and get rid of whatever it is that was bringing compromise and corruption in their midst. We're going to look at the message under three perspectives. Number one, the description of Christ and the diagnosis of the church. The description of Christ to this church and the diagnosis of the church. Number two, defilement and destruction through compromise. Compromise comes in and then defilement will come in. Compromise comes in and destruction will come in. And then point number three will be the delight and destiny of overcoming Christians. The delight and destiny of overcoming Christians. Number one is the description of Christ and the diagnosis of the church. Revelation chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 12. Revelation chapter 2, we're looking at verse 12. It says, unto the angel of the church in Pergamos write, these things saith he which has the sharp sword with two edges, I know thy works, and where thou dwellest, even where Satan's seat is, and thou holdest fast my name, and hast not denied my faith, even in those days wherein Antipas was my faithful martyr, who was slain among you where Satan dwelleth. The Lord introduced himself to the church. And as he introduced himself to the church, he says, number one, he has the sharp sword with two edges coming out of his mouth. Why? What's the reason for that? He will fight against those compromisers, those perverse people, those perverted people. He'll fight against them with the sword coming from his mouth. To the compromising church, Christ is not presented as a loving Savior, a tender Savior, a compassionate Lord, but is introduced to them as a firm, frightening judge. This describes the office of Christ as judge. The sharp, two-edged sword is his word of judgment, which will soon cut down the sinners, cut down the backsliders, and cut down the compromisers. I pray that that sword will not work against you on the final day in Jesus' name. I look at Christ as is described in Revelation chapter 19. Revelation chapter 19, I'm reading from verse 15. In Revelation chapter 19, verse 15, it says, and out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he shall smite the nations. He'll smite the Gentile nations. He'll smite the evil nations. He'll smite the corrupted, perverted nations. And then he'll also smite the corruptors and the compromisers in the church. And he shall root them with a rod of iron. And he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and the wrath of Almighty God. That's verse 15. Why don't you look at verse 21? In verse 21 of that same chapter 19, it says, and the remnant was slain with the sword of him him that sat upon the horse. That's the conqueror. That's the Lord Jesus Christ, the conquering Lord, the conquering master, and the conquering king. It says he slays them, he destroys them, he kills them, he judges them with the word, the sword of his mouth. The sword which proceedeth out of his mouth, and all the fowls were filled with their flesh. Come back to chapter 2 of Revelation, and we're looking at verse 16, and see the threatening of the Lord against these compromising people, these corrupted people, and these perverse people. It says in Revelation chapter 2 verse 16, repent, or else I will come unto thee quickly, and will fight against them with the sword of my mouth. The Lord then is not tolerating sin, is fighting against sin. The Lord is not excusing sin, is fighting against sin. And when there is sin, when there is corruption, when there is backsliding in the church, and the leadership of the church does not deal with it, we leave it in the hands of the Lord to deal with it in such a violent way, in such a serious way. And that's why it says that we should humble ourselves, go back to the cross. If there is sin, if there's corruption, compromise entering in there, go back to the cross and settle that, and then there'll be forgiveness, there'll be grace, there'll be love, and the judgment of God will not fall upon us anymore in Jesus' name. You see, there, I said the wrath of God will not fall upon us in Jesus' name. Before blotting out those corrupting influence of compromise in the church, Christ first reveals before pointing that out, he first reveals areas of faithfulness. You think about Christ, what a wonderful Savior we serve, and what a wonderful Lord we serve. He's even going to tell them now some good things in that church, which means it wasn't all bad. The faltering church even has some good points. This feeble church had some good points, and this church filled with faults that Jesus Christ wanted to correct still has some good points. And he began to tell them what those good points were, areas of faithfulness which was commendable in that church, the church of the city where Satan's seat is. And then he said the city was the seat of Satan, the very center of Caesar's worship. That's what it means when it says it's a place where Satan's seat is. Caesar's worship was central there. If Caesar occupied the throne that God should have occupied there, the Roman Empire, it became over there to Pergamos to come and sacrifice to this Zeus that had been a massive idol that had been put there in the midst of the people. Yet, thank God, the church held fast Christ's name, and the church stood steadfastly, adhering to everything that the name of Jesus Christ stood for. They did not deny the faith in Christ, even in the face of opposition and martyrdom. Our Lord Jesus Christ commended their faithfulness and steadfastness. Look at that in verse 13. We're looking at Revelation chapter 2 verse 13. I know thy works, and where thou dwellest. There are some people that think that if a place is difficult, we cannot plant a church there. If a place is occultic, we cannot have a church there. They say if a place is idolatrous, we cannot have a church there. They say if a church is satanic, we cannot have a church there. But look at Pergamos. The church was there. The church will be everywhere. I said the church will be everywhere. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, and all the people that are therein, the Lord has made them. Jesus died for everyone. Because Jesus died for everyone, we're going to preach the gospel to every creature, everywhere, in Jesus' name. Even if Satan's seat is there, even if there is an idol man, an idol wherever they are worshiping there, we're going to take the name of Jesus everywhere. We're going to take the gospel of Jesus everywhere. We're going to take the salvation of Jesus everywhere. And the people of those who are going to be saved, they will be saved, and there will be a church there in Jesus' name. And a church there will not be a faltering church. It will be a lively church. It will be a mighty church. It will be a powerful church. It will be a church that the gates of hell cannot prevail against in Jesus' name. So he says, I know thy works and where thou dwellest and where Satan's seat is, and thou holdest fast my name. Thou holdest fast my name. Thou holdest fast my name. The people were trying to tell them or show them, hold this with a loose hand. You have two hands. Why don't you hold this with one hand and then hold Caesar with another hand? Why don't you hold the truth with one hand and hold error with another hand? Why don't you hold, hold religion loosely? You want to live. You have a work, you have a family to feed, and you have a life to live. And if you don't, if you're too serious and fanatical, if you're too committed and consecrated, if you're too sold into this kind of religion, you're not going to make any headway in this community. You can hold it with a loose hand, but they said no. They held the name of the Lord, the authority of the power of the Lord. They held that with a fast hand. They held that fast. They held that fast. They will not let it go. And I pray that we will embrace this gospel. I said we will embrace this gospel. You will hold it fast in your life in Jesus' name. And it says, thou hast not denied my faith. Thou hast not denied my faith. They were challenging him. Put your faith in Caesar. Put your faith in a man. Put your faith in a woman. Put your confidence and your trust in so and so, in such and such. Because you see, they wanted to ship them away. They said, you can go to church. That's all right. You can go to church. They wanted the church to be a social club where you just go, but there's no heart there. There's no face there. And there's no passion there. There's no commitment there. There's no consecration there. They didn't want them to be sold out to the gospel of the Lord. But these people said, no, we're going to hold it fast. We will not deny the faith of Jesus. Even in those days where Antipas, who was my faithful martyr, who was my faithful servant, who died for the faith, who was slain among you where Satan dwelleth. That church has suffered martyrdom, just like Stephen was killed. Then another person here, Antipas, was also killed. But the people didn't say, I must be careful now. I must practice this sin carefully, because the two Antipas, who knows, they might also take me. They knew that sudden death is sudden glory. They remembered when Stephen was dying, he saw the heavens open and he saw the Son of Man, Jesus Christ, standing on the right hand of majesty on high. And he said, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. They were not afraid. You will not be afraid. I said, you will not be afraid. That whatever they are going to do and whatever they threaten to do, you will stand and you'll stand firm in Jesus' name. It tells us, that they held fast. And see the challenge they posed to us. As they held fast, we are going to hold fast. I said we are going to hold fast. Titus chapter 1 verse 9. Titus chapter 1 verse 9. This is the commission we're given. And this example that this church in Pergamos, that they have led for us in Titus chapter 1 verse 9, holding fast the faithful word. Holding fast the faithful word. Don't hold Christianity with a loose hand. With both of your hands, with your heart and mind, you hold it fast. It's planted inside you and it's hidden inside you and it is firm inside there, holding fast the faithful word as he has been taught, that he may be, that he may be able by sound doctrine both to exhort and to convince the gainsayers. The gainsayers or the naysayers will come to you. That is also saying no to the doctrine. The naysayers, they'll come to you and they'll try to beat you off the path of righteousness. You are holding fast. They will not be able to take it away from your hand in Jesus' name. Let's look at Timothy, 2 Timothy chapter 1. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 13. It tells us, hold fast the form of sound words. Sound doctrine, sound teaching, and proper teaching of the word of God. Hold it fast. You see, there are people, they say they are Christians. Some even say they are ministers. But they hold the word of God on the one hand, and then all the principles of the world and the proverbs of the world. And they depend on encyclopedia. They depend upon the wisdom of the world, upon the good sayings of other religions. Buddha has said something, they quote it. Confucius has said something, they quote it, and another person has said something, they quote it, and it's just a collection of religious ideas, religious ideologies, and then they bring in the name of Jesus among you know, all those other people. It's called the New Age movement. New Age movement. They pick a little from Christianity, a little from Buddhism, a little from Hinduism, a little from this and from that, and then they mix it all together. And it's the wisdom of the ancients, the wisdom of the ages. And that's error. That's erroneous. All that you'll tell you'll throw away from your life in Jesus' name. And if you have all those books in your library that will, you know, talk of this and compare Jesus Christ with them, and those ones, they're just religious people. They don't have anything that actually saves. It says you throw that away, and in verse 13, you hold fast the form of sound words which thou hast heard of me in faith and love which is in Christ Jesus. It says that good thing, verse 14, that good thing which was committed unto me, keep by the Holy Ghost which dwelleth in you. I pray you'll do that firmly in Jesus' name. In Philippians chapter 1, verse 27, Philippians chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 27. It tells us how we ought to hold fast the word of God. Only let your conversation be as it becomes the gospel of Christ, that whether I come and see you or else be absent. Obviously, Paul the apostle was saying, I cannot be everywhere because I'm not God. I cannot be everywhere at the same time. Corinth is there, and Philippi is there, and Colossae is there, Thessalonica is there, and all the other, Rome is there, all the other places are there. I can only be in one place at a particular time. So you Philippians, whether I am there with you physically or not, here is what you are going to do. Just let your conversation and your manner of life and your character and your communion and your commitment, let it be as it becomes the gospel of Christ, that whether I come and see you or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs, that ye stand fast in one spirit, that she stand firm in one spirit, that she are holding fast in one spirit, and with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel, united with the faith of the gospel. We're looking at Hebrews chapter 3. Hebrews chapter 3. It is if we hold this firm and hold it fast until the very end, we'll be able to have a part with him on that final day. Hebrews chapter 3, verse 6. It says in Hebrews chapter 3, verse 6, but Christ as a son over his own house, whose house we are. If there's a condition, if we're going to remain the household of faith, there's a condition, if we're going to remain members of the temple of the Lord Jesus Christ, it says whose house we are, if we hold fast the confidence and the rejoicing of the hope firm unto the end. We're holding it first, we're holding it firm unto the end. It will show you then the danger of just holding the doctrines of the Bible loosely, and just, you know, anything can, you know, take it away from your hand, anything can strike it away from your heart. Once another interesting thing comes, you drop this faith and you drop this doctrine and you drop this teaching, and then you're up to another thing. Or maybe you're supposed to come, you know, we're supposed to be at the workers retreat all together, and you see the newspapers, they're announcing that there's a program somewhere there, and then there's another thing over there. They announce that for their people. They have to do that to inform their people. You are not part of their people. Whatever is happening in all the other places, you are going to stand firm in the word of God. I said you stand firm in the word of God. You're not of the people that are shopping for, you're shopping for feeling good. I want somebody to do something there and make me feel good. You're not just, you're a member of the family of God, and you're holding fast the word of the Lord. We thank the Lord for what God is doing in our church right now. I said we thank the Lord for what God is doing in our church right now. We're hearing testimonies that we've not had for many years. The renewal of this is a new season of power. I said it's a new season of power. And you'll be a partaker in Jesus' name. I don't need to tell you, you know it yourself. And I don't need to, you know, remind you. You can even remind me yourself that this month of August, August is going to be a breakthrough. I said August time is going to be a breakthrough. And you know, tell your children and all the secondary school young people there everywhere, all of us in Lagos over here, we're coming here on the 17th, 17th of what month? Of August, and then on the 18th, and those 2 days, 17th and 18th, 17 and 18, I'm telling you, that 17, a new season of power, something will come upon your life. Showers of blessing, showers will come upon your life in Jesus' name. The Lord is waking up the church. The Lord is reviving the church. You don't want to miss it. You've been here in January, and you've been here February, you've been here March and April and May and June and July, and now this is August. It remains you've done 7 out of 12. All the months of this year, I will not be absent in Jesus' name. I said I will not be absent in Jesus' name. And this season of power will capture you. This season of power will captivate you. And this season of power will energize you in Jesus' name. Whatever other announcement you read in any other place, or you know, you hear over the radio, you hear whatever it is, something else is taking place in any other place on that 17th of August, that 17th of August, I am here, you are here. I said I'm here, you are here. I can't hear your voice. Maybe I can see your hand if you are here. Can I see your hand? You will be here. You will be here. You will be here. And that showers of blessing will come upon your life in Jesus' name. And tell all the people, every local government in this country, every region in this country, every nation in this continent of Africa and beyond, on that 17th of August, this thing we're holding it firm. I said we're holding it firm, and nothing will take it away from you in Jesus' name. Tell everybody, those who are not here, go and tell your members. When you get, you are the angel over the local church there, the angel over those groups of people there, and you want to bring everyone so that a new refreshing will come upon every life in Jesus' name. If we abide, if we remain and hold fast unto the end, see the blessing that will come upon our lives. Look at that. Hebrews chapter 3, verse 12. Verse 12 says, take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. You will not depart. I said you will not depart, but exhort one another daily while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. For we are made partakers of Christ if we hold fast, if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast unto the very end. You will hold fast in Jesus' name. I come to point number 2 now. See what happened to this church. Well, looking at Revelation chapter 2. Revelation chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 14. Here is a challenge that Jesus Christ brought to the church. Here is the condemnation that the church got into, the defilement and the destruction through compromise. Defilement and destruction through compromise. Revelation chapter 2, verse 14. But I have a few things against thee. What a pity. That even though they were standing firm, they were holding to his faith, holding on to the face of the Lord Jesus Christ. And yet Jesus said, you've not done that perfectly. You've not done that perfectly. I have a few things against you. A few things against you. You know, there are people, they don't know that God is going to look at every detail of their lives, every detail of the ministry, every detail of what we do. And they just look at this is good and that is good and this is normal and this is wonderful. I have all these other things too. Put your finger there in Revelation chapter 2 and come to Jeremiah chapter 48. Jeremiah chapter 48. Jeremiah chapter 48. I'm reading from verse 10 there. Jeremiah chapter 48, verse 10. It says, cursed be he that doeth the work of the Lord deceitfully. He doeth the work of the Lord, but he doesn't go to the very limit. He does it deceitfully. He doeth the work of the Lord. He doesn't do it wholeheartedly. He does it half-heartedly. He doeth the work of the Lord. He doesn't do it completely. He doesn't do it completely. He goes just halfway. And the word of God says, cursed be he that doeth the work of the Lord deceitfully. Look at the end of that. It says in that verse 10, and cursed be he that keepeth back the sword from the blood. That is, they keep back the word of God, the sword of the spirit, from touching the hearts of the people, from pinching the hearts of the people, from convicting the hearts of the people. They just said all these things and they motivate people, and people are happy, and their sins are not dug up, and their sins are not pointed out. It says, cursed be he that keeps the sword of the word of God away from touching the hearts of the people and piercing them and leading them and driving them to conviction and to conversion. And that's the reason why the Lord was telling this church, we are back now in Revelation chapter 2, that this church, the leadership there did not take care. That's why Jesus said, nevertheless, but I have a few things against thee, because thou hast there them that hold the doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel, and to eat things sacrificed unto idols, and to commit fornication. You see here, although on the one hand they appeared like they were almost overdone, on the one hand it was a cake not torn. One side was rotting and the other side was burnt. It appeared the heat was on one side and then there was no heat on the other side at all. They were only looking at one area. Are there not sometimes churches like that, and branches of our own deeper life like that? Did they have a program, but then there's no purity? They have all those, all these things, programs are there, but to lead the people to purity of life, that is not there. They gloss over a lot of things, and a lot of things are coming over here. It talks about the compromise of these people. It said there is a Balaam there. There's a man who professes to be a prophet, who professes to have some spiritual gifts. Instead of spiritual gifts leading people to salvation, sanctification, and holiness, it was leading them to corruption, leading them to commit fornication, and then to eat things sacrificed unto idols. Look at verse 15. So as thou also them that hold the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which sin I hate. Look at the Lord Jesus Christ talking pointedly to the minister there, and he says, there's something I hate, and I find that thing I hate in your midst. You love what I hate. You embrace what I hate. You tolerate what I hate. And what were the things? Well, as we look at the whole scene, looking at the church, number one, there was moral laxity. It's just that, you know, we shouldn't be too much serious. The people want to come. The young people want to come. And don't be too hard on them morally. Let them just lose themselves and fellowship together. They might even dance together, kiss together, embrace together, and whatever it is. There was no moral standard anymore. Number one, there was moral laxity. Number two, ministerial levity. The ministers there, plurality of ministers, when I say ministers, house fellowship leader and zonal leader and the women rep and the local pastors and the overseers of regions and of states and of nations, were all ministers. Ministerial levity came in their midst. The compromising spirit of Balaam came upon them, that instead of being firm, instead of being serious, instead of standing straight on the word of God, there was this levity and looseness and superficiality and frivolity. I pray that God will take that away from amidst in Jesus' name. Number three, there was mindless liberty. You know, the liberty that you don't touch anyone, don't correct anyone, and don't frown at anything, and it has no mind. It was a mindless kind of liberty, that, you know, we have liberty, and the word of God doesn't have any part to play anymore. There is no standard. It was just a mindless liberty. And the Lord is saying, anywhere you have moral laxity, anywhere you have ministerial levity, anywhere you have mindless liberty, everything is going to collapse. Corruption is going to come in. Compromise is going to come in. Number four is marital looseness. That, you know, after all, they will taste each other as if you are tasting wine. And then because Balaam was telling them, how do you know how a person is going to be if they can give you love and give you what whatever it is, a pleasure, if you don't test each other one out. So then, you know, one man will go to that lady in the church, and then they are messing up, and then will say that one is not good enough, will go to this other one, and they are messing up, will go to another one, and marital kind of looseness came into that church. Praying for the will of God, they've forgotten about that. One man, one wife, until death do us part, they've forgotten that. Staying together and sticking together according to the will of God, they've forgotten all that. Look at the kind of life they were living because of the influence of Balaam in their midst. I pray that God will purge and perfect his church in Jesus' name. Marital looseness. And then number five is manifold lawlessness. Manifold lawlessness. The influence of Balaam so came much upon them that as Balaam was influencing them, get loose, you know, do whatever you want to do. After all, it's all body matter, it's all flesh, it's all flesh. The hand is flesh, or, you know, delicate parts, all that is flesh. What do they call fornication? Everything is flesh. Don't worry about that. Your soul is separate, your soul is different. And as they got into all that, you know, Balaam almost took over. The idea, the ideology, the principle of Balaam took over that church, and there was no holiness or righteousness anymore because there's this manifold lawlessness. There's no law anywhere anymore. Any law controlling marriage, controlling orderliness in the church, controlling sanctity in the church, sanctification in the church, holiness in the church, lawlessness took over. Manifold lawlessness. And then number six is a meaningless labor. Meaningless labor. They still were, you know, we're working for God, but when there's no holiness, what work are we doing? When there's no repentance, what work are we doing? And when there is no restitution, what work are we doing? When there's no righteousness, no righteous standard anymore, what work are we doing? Only a few people, Antipas, gave his life and he even died, but all the rest of the people is like just religion without righteousness, meaningless labor, and eventually mysterious leaven. Mysterious leaven. It was like, you know, the pastor there now became helpless because he didn't know that the leaven, that little sin was so spread in the church and corrupt everything. A little leaven leaveneth the whole lump. And I pray that God will purge our church in Jesus' name. And all the things that come in as mysterious leaven, the Lord will purge take everything away, and they will not have any way, any root, and any corrupting influence in our church anymore in the name of Jesus. Let us look at 1 Corinthians chapter 5. 1 Corinthians chapter 5. I'm reading here from verse 6. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 6. Your glorying is not good. Know ye not that a little leaven lifteth the whole lump? Know ye not that it's like walking in a mysterious way. It comes in, there's a little crack in the wall of sanctification. There's a little crack in the wall of holiness. And that little crack, a little leaven will come in there. A little corruption will come in there. A little liberty will come in there. A little levity will come in there. A little laxity will come in there. Before you know what, everything is already defiled. I pray that that defilement this very day, the Lord will purge everything, cleanse everything away from this, our church, in Jesus' name, so that we will still be able to stand on this word of God, and nothing will pollute this word of God in our hands, in our knees, in the mighty name of Jesus. Give me a good amen over there. We're looking at Galatians chapter 5. Galatians chapter 5. We're reading from verse 7 all through to verse 9 as we look at our church. And then we're studying this church in Pergamos. And we want to make sure that all this laxity and the levity and the lawlessness and the liberty and the looseness and the labor that is meaningless, and this leaven will not take root in our church in Jesus' name. Galatians chapter 5. I read from verse 7. Ye did run well. Who did hinder you that he should not obey the truth? This persuasion cometh not of him that calleth you. A little leaven leaveneth the whole lump. A little leaven leaveneth the whole lump. And that was the challenge and the problem in that church, that they didn't understand. They didn't allow God to work mightily in their midst. And if we're going to have the church standing as the church ought to stand, these seven things might taken away completely and never to come near our church in any branch in Jesus' name. I remind you, number one, moral laxity, tighten up. Tighten your belt and all the laxity that people are claiming morally, we kind of repent of that and take it, and ministerial levity. Let our ministers be sober. Let our ministers be serious. Let our ministers be focused. Let our ministers go in the right direction, that we say that this is where we stand. There must be a standard, and you must be an example of laying down that standard. And then the mindless liberty, you know, I'm free to do whatever it is. I'm just in the church. I will pick what I want. I will accept what I want. Whatever I don't want, well, that's between me and God. You cannot be like that. Your attitude affects other people. Your commitment affects other people. Your righteousness affects other people. And your sin affects other people too. The mindless liberty will go. And the marital looseness, start from your own family. Let the husband and the wife be together. Let them pray together. Let them seek together. Let them walk together. Let them do everything together. And let the people around you see that this man and this woman, they are united and they are together, and there's no marital looseness. And then all our young people who are planning to get married, we will pray, and God will give you bone of your bone and flesh of your flesh in Jesus' name. Don't allow immorality to, you know, to spread in the church. It's going to be like cancer that kills the church. Keep to yourself until that time of marriage. And then if there be somebody is married already, but she's not with the husband, you will find that you're not just going to marry somebody and say, I found a sister. Is she married or is she a widow or whatever it is? And we will cleanse the whole system of marriage in the church in Jesus' name. All the marital looseness, everything will be taken out of the way, and we stand according to this unchanging word. And the mindless lawlessness, that you're almost like a law to yourself, in Judges chapter 17. Judges chapter 17, we see these people, lawlessness in the midst of the people. It will not be so anymore here. I said it will not be so anymore here. We're looking at Judges chapter 17, verse 1. It says, in those days, there was no king in Israel. Chapter 18, verse 1. I now come to chapter 17, verse 6. In those days, there was no king in Israel, but every man did that which was right in his own eyes. Lawlessness. Every man did that which was now right in his own eyes. No reference to the Bible. No reference to the law of Moses. No reference to the gospel. No reference to the doctrine. No reference to the preaching. No reference to the messages we're preaching. There must be a reference. There must be a point of reference. This is what the word of God says on such a thing. But in the case of these people, in those days, every man did that which was right in his own eyes, because there was no king in the land. There is a king in the church, and his name is Jesus. I said his name is Jesus. And he said, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. Look at chapter 19, verse 1. It's all over in the book of the Judges. In chapter 19, verse 1, Judges, it says, and it came to pass in those days when there was no king in Israel. But thank God, our king is still alive. Our Redeemer, our Lord is still alive. And him we're going to obey in Jesus' name. Look at Judges chapter 21, verse 25. Judges 21, verse 25. In those days, there was no king in Israel. Every man did that which was right in his own eyes. That's the manifold lawlessness in the land at that time. And the church in Pergamos, they allowed that in their midst. That lawlessness in their midst. All that will not be anymore in Jesus' name. meaningless labor. You ask yourself, what's the meaning of this? This labor, this activity, this program, and this, you know, this thing we're doing. There must be a meaning to it. There must be a contribution to it. Myself, am I a meaningless member of the church? What am I contributing myself? Am I a meaningless member in the section of the work in which I've been put? I must contribute something. What are you contributing there? And as you are here together, it's not only our group pastors, it's not only our region overseers, it's not only our national or state overseers, every one of us, you must have something to contribute. Otherwise, it will be as if your presence there is a meaningless kind of thing. You'll not be a meaningless member of the church in Jesus' name. And then the mysterious leaven, all that will be cleansed away in Jesus' name. We come to point number three, and that is the delight and destiny of overcoming Christians. The delight and the destiny of overcoming Christians. We're looking at Revelation chapter 2, reading from verse 16 and verse 17. Revelation chapter 2, verse 16, repent, or else I will come unto thee quickly and will fight against them with the sword of my mouth. Remember, it's Jesus talking here. And Jesus, who normally should love us and love his church, because he loved his church and he gave himself for it, he said, but there are people in that church now, instead of being compassionate towards them, instead of showing mercy to them, I'm going to come, I'm going to fight against them with the sword in my mouth. Except they repent, he still left the door of grace open. He still left the chance to repent. He still left that open. He said, if they will repent, I'll forgive. If they will repent, I will pardon. If they will repent, I will cleanse them. If they will repent, I'll make them a pillar in my church. Whatever they have done in the past, the mercy of God is there. But if they remain adamant, if they remain stubborn in their corrupting influence of the church, then I'm going to fight against them. Verse 17, he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. To him that overcometh, to him that overcometh, that's me. I said, that's me. You will overcome in Jesus' name. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone, and in the stone a new name written, which no man knoweth, saving he that receiveth it. The Lord is talking about the people that overcome. And he says, first of all, but he says, repent. That word of repentance is, you find that all through the New Testament, from Matthew to Mark to Luke and to Acts of the Apostles and to Romans, and then to all the epistles, and in Revelation now, he talks about repent. Can I just show you a few instances where he says we must repent? In Acts of the Apostles chapter 3, Acts of the Apostles chapter 3, and what great blessings and what great refreshing comes with that repentance. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 3, we're looking at verse 19, repent ye therefore, change your mind towards him, change your mind towards society, change your mind towards the polluting world and the perverted world. It says, repent ye therefore and be converted. If we truly repent, there'll be a conversion. If we truly repent, there'll be a transformation. If we truly repent, there'll be a change. The places we went before, we no more go there. The dresses, those kind of tight-fitting dresses that bring temptation, that shows the anatomy of your body as a man or as a woman, you'll not do that anymore. The hairdo that is just like the people of the world, that when they see you like this, they'll think that you're on the other side. They think that you're a person of the world. All that will repent of them. The language of our mouth, when we repent, there will be a change in that language, and the things we used to say, and all those dirty things and all those nauseating things we used to say, will not say them anymore, because there is repentance. Repentance affects your soul, affects your spirit, affects your heart, affects your attitude, affects your disposition, affects your brain, affects your mind, affects your way of life, affects your lifestyle, affects your dressing, affects your friendship, affects the places you go, and affects the people you relate with. That's repentance. It's a kind of total repentance that affects you through and through. Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing shall come come from the presence of the Lord, and he shall send Jesus Christ, which before was preached unto you, whom the heaven must receive until the times of restitution, restoration, refreshing of all sins, which God has spoken by the mouth of all his holy prophets since the world began. I pray that such practical repentance, refreshing repentance, and life transforming repentance will be in every one of our lives in Jesus' name. Acts of the Apostles chapter 17. Acts of the Apostles chapter 17. And I'm reading from verse 30 and verse 31. Acts of the Apostles chapter 17. We're looking at verse 30. It says, and the times of this ignorance God winked at. What does that mean? Well, I'm hearing some things that I didn't know that before. And some things had been exposed to me now in the preaching of the word of God. I didn't know that before. God says, that's all right. The times of ignorance, he winked at. But now that we know, now that is to our knowledge, now that we see the rebuke of the Lord Jesus Christ concerning the church in Pergamos, and we see the reason why he was rebuking them, and all the laxity and the levity and the lawlessness and the liberty and all the looseness and all the mysterious leaven, we want to cast all that aside. Now we know, and because we now know, that's why he says he commanded all men everywhere to repent, because he has appointed a day in the which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he has ordained, whereof he has given assurance unto all men, in that he has raised him from the dead. That repentance will be real in every one of our lives in Jesus' name. And we're looking at the word of God in Revelation chapter 3. What he tells us, Revelation chapter 3, we're reading from verse 19. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. You know, some people have a different understanding of love. They think that if you love them, that we shall allow the influence of Balaam to remain there. If you love them, we shall allow the doctrine and the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which Christ hates, to remain there. No, it says, if somebody is doing evil, and that evil will lead him to perdition, will lead her to the judgment of God, if you want them, that's the love of God. It says, as many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous therefore and repent. Be zealous therefore and repent. Be zealous therefore and repent. Let repentance characterize your life and characterize you, and then great blessings will come upon us in Jesus' name. We're looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 2, and we're reading from verse 9 and verse 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9. But as it is written, eye has not seen, and nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of men. That Jesus said, I'm going to give him hidden manna. You've never seen this. You've never tasted this. But this is what I'm going to give to the people that repent, and for the people that return, and for the people that reconnect with me. I'm going to give them all this. And that's why it says, what eyes have never seen, what has never entered into the heart of man, the things which God has prepared for them that love him. But God has revealed them unto us by his Spirit, for the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the very deep things of God. I pray that those deep and great mighty things of God, the Lord will grant unto you, grant unto me, grant unto us together in Jesus' name. This church will no more be faltering. This church will no more be feeble. This church will no more fade. We're going to remain strong in Jesus' name. But you see, he counseled the church. He told the church what the church must do so that we will have what we ought to have. It says, I'm reading now Revelation chapter 2. Revelation chapter 2, verse 17. He that has an ear, let him hear. He that has an ear, let him hear. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh. How do we overcome? To him that overcometh. How do we overcome? And what do we overcome? Number one, sins corruption. Sins corruption. The corruption coming from the world. Corruption by the world. Overcome that. Anything is coming your direction is coming. It comes through Balaam. or it comes through another source, it comes through false doctrine, it comes through the Nicolaitans. It says, he that overcometh, you want to overcome sin's corruption, the corruption coming from the world through anyone or through any avenue. Number two, you overcome Satan's control. You see, Satan was in that place trying to control everything because Satan had a siege there. And Satan will like control your life, control your thinking. And he tries to control through the media. He tries to control through the internet. He tries to control through all those pornographic things. He tries to control through whatever it is. He tries to control through society. He tries to control through covenant with this and covenant with that. But if the overcomer is the one, number one, that overcomes sin's corruption. Number two, that overcomes Satan's control that leads to compromise with the world. When you begin to imbibe the principles of the world, you begin to read all those things of the world, and then the control of Satan comes, you begin to change your convictions, begin to, you know, tone down a little here, tone down a little here, change that, loosen up a little here, loosen up a little here. That's Satan's control affecting you to compromise with the world. You overcome sin's corruption, number one. You overcome Satan's control, number two. You overcome, number three, the seducer's counsel. The seducer's counsel. The seducer's counsel. Seducers will come to counsel you. And when they do it, seducers are clever. They're seductive. Seductive. And because of that, you may not know until you are enticed and you go into something that is evil. God will keep you. God will preserve you. And the blood of Jesus will circle around you. And all that sensuality, all that counsel of the seducers will not be able to come into you in Jesus' name. Because it is that will bring condemnation with the world. If you're going to escape the corruption coming from the world, if you're going to escape the compromise of the world, if you're going to escape the condemnation coming with the world, then you're going to overcome all these three areas, since corruption and Satan's control and seducer's counsel, they will not have effect in your life in Jesus' name. I will be an overcomer. I will be an overcomer. I said I will be an overcomer. And no matter how strong the temptation, the enticement, and the counsel, and the influence of the people of the world may be, I will overcome in Jesus' name. You'll overcome. Just stand up right now and tell the Lord you want to be an overcomer. Be an overcomer. Be an overcomer. All these things will come. It will try to corrupt the church. It will try to confuse the church. It will try to crush the church. It will try to bring us to conform and to compromise with the world. But we're saying, oh Lord, make me an overcomer. Make me an overcomer. Make me an overcomer. I will overcome. You tell the Lord you'll overcome. The grace is available. The grace is available. It will make you overcome.